हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर निधि अग्रवाल फ्रॉम जामिया हमदर्द। वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। टुडे वी विल स्टडी अबाउट फेज 4 ऑफ क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स एंड फार्माकोविजिलेंस अंडर द मॉड्यूल प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट पार्ट 2। इन दिस वी विल लर्न अबाउट पोस्ट मार्केटिंग सर्विलेंस एंड कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ फार्माकोविजिलेंस। To start with, phase 4. Phase 4 trials are often termed as post-marketing surveillance. The Food and Drug Administration requires continued evaluation after release to evaluate safety signs that may affect the benefit-risk ratio. Post-marketing trials are studies other than routine surveillance performed after drug approval and related to the approved indications. Phase 4 trials include additional drug-drug interaction, dose response, or safety studies and trial designs to support use under the approved indication. Example: mortality or morbidity studies, epidemiological studies, etc. A thorough knowledge is obtained after the drug has been marketed and hundreds of thousands of patients exposed to the product through commercial sales. This is so because of the primary reasons. First being, it is not possible to study more than a few thousand of patients in clinical trial. Second, a lot of additional knowledge about the drugs come from scientific rather than commercial interest through research done by individual workers in universities and research institutions and by the group of investigators with academic interest in the drug or in therapeutics. Third, some of the new knowledge about a drug is obtained by serendipity when doctors all over the world use the drug in a wide spectrum of patients with varied ethnicity, varied underlying diseases, and a range of concomitant medication. Non-interventional studies, these are the studies conducted to assess safety, tolerability, and effectiveness of marketed medicines in clinical practice. They are basically the large simple trials. It is a hybrid between a randomized clinical trial and an observational study, for example, a cohort study where a large number of participants are randomized to treatment groups with follow-up per routine practice. It is simply referred to the efforts of enrolling physicians and participants, and the objective is to interfere with routine practice as little as possible. Now coming back to the post-marketing studies, post-marketing surveillance study is a non-interventional study requested by the regulatory authorities in order to verify the safety, tolerability, and effectiveness of a marketed drug in a particular population per the locally approved label. Periodic safety update reports are filed at regular intervals for such studies. Outcomes of such studies could be signals, pharmacoepidemiological information, need for controlled studies, labels changing with modified undesirable effects section, indications and dosing schedules, and regulatory action, which includes the boxed warning or the withdrawal of the drug. There are case control studies as well. Some of these studies may be retrospective case control evaluation, and these are basically done to evaluate a rare suspected side effect. Cohort as well as the cross-sectional studies may also be done as part of comparative observational studies in further pharmacovigilance planning. Drug utilization studies. These are the studies which describe how a drug is marketed, prescribed, and used in a population and how these factors influence outcomes, including the clinical, economic, and social outcomes. These studies basically provide the data on specific population, for example, geriatric, pediatric, or the patient with hepatic or renal dysfunction, and it is often being stratified by age, gender, concomitant medication, and the other characteristics. These studies can be used to determine if a product is being used in these populations. Post-authorization safety studies. Any study relating to an authorized medicinal product conducted with the aim of identifying, characterizing, or quantifying a safety hazard, or it can be done to confirm the safety profile of a medicinal product or to measure the effectiveness of risk management measures. The objectives of post-authorization safety studies include to characterize the safety profile of a medicine, to provide reassurance about the absence of a safety concern related to a specific adverse reaction, to investigate potential or identified risks, to evaluate risk of a medicinal product used in authorized indication by patient groups not studied in the pre-authorization phase, to assess patterns of utilization and use of the medicinal product that may have an impact on its safety. Lastly, to evaluate the effectiveness of a risk minimization activity. Post-authorization safety studies can be clinical trials or non-interventional studies. A PASS is non-interventional if the following requirements are cumulatively fulfilled. First being, the medicinal product is prescribed in the usual manner in accordance with the terms of the marketing authorization. Second, the assignment of the patient to a particular therapeutic strategy is not decided in advance by a trial protocol but falls within current practice, and the prescription of the medicine is clearly separated from the decision to include the patient in the study. There is no additional diagnostic or monitoring procedures are applied to the patients. Non-intervention studies include database research or review of records where all the events of interest have already been happened, and this may include cohort studies, cross-sectional studies, or case control studies. The non-interventional studies include those involving primary data collection, for example, the prospective observational studies, and the registries in which the data collected derive from a routine clinical care. In these studies, interviews, questionnaires, and blood samples may be performed as a part of the normal clinical practice. Other study design may also be utilized in order to generate the secondary use of the data. Coming to the term registries, a registry is an organized system that uses observational methods to collect uniform data on specified outcomes in a population defined by a particular disease, exposure, or condition. The disease or outcome registries, such as registries of blood dyscrasias or cutaneous reaction or the congenital malformation, it may help in collecting the data on the drug exposure and the other factors which are associated with the clinical condition. A properly designed and executed registries can provide a real worldwide view of clinical practice, patient outcomes, safety, and comparative effectiveness. Exposure registries address population exposed to medicinal products of interest. Example, registry of the rheumatoid arthritis patient who are being exposed to the biological therapies. Some exposure registries address exposures to medicinal product in specific population, such as pregnant females. Patients may be followed over time to collect data on the adverse events using the standardized questionnaires. There are certain non-interventional studies which are described further as first observational studies. In this, first we will cover the cross-sectional study or the survey. Data collected on a population of patients at a single point in time or interval of time, regardless of exposure or disease status, constitute a cross-sectional study. Cohort study. Population at risk for an event of interest is followed over time for the occurrence of that event. Information on exposure status is known throughout the follow-up period for each patient. A patient might be exposed to a medicinal product at one time during follow-up but non-exposed at another time. Since the population exposure during follow-up is known, incidence rates can be calculated. Population at risk for an event of interest is followed over time for the occurrence of that event. The information on exposure status is known throughout the follow-up period for each patient. A patient might be exposed to a medicinal product at one time during follow-up but not exposed at another time point. Since the population exposure during follow-up is known, incidence rates can be calculated. Multiple adverse events may be investigated using the same data source in a cohort study. There is a difficulty in recruiting the sufficient number of patients who are exposed to a product of interest, such as an orphan drug, or to study the very rare outcomes, and these are termed as orphan diseases. The identification of patients for cohort studies may come from large automated databases or from data collected specifically for the study at hand. It may be used to examine safety concern in special population like the elderly, children, patients with comorbid conditions and pregnant females through oversampling of these patients or by stratifying the cohort if sufficient number of patients exist. Case control study. In a case control study, cases of disease or events are identified and patients without the disease or event of interest at the time of selection are then selected as controls from the source population that gave rise to the cases. The exposure status of the two groups is then compared using the odds ratio, which is an estimate of relative risk of disease among the exposed as compared to the non-exposed patients. Patients may be identified from an existing database or using data collected specifically for the purpose of the study of interest. This is particularly useful when the goal is to investigate whether there is an association between a medicinal product or the products and one specific rare event, as well as to identify the risk factors associated with the adverse event. These risk factors may include conditions such as renal and hepatic dysfunction, which might modify the relationship between the drug exposure and the adverse event. This was about the observational studies. Now we will move to clinical trials. When significant risks are identified from pre-approval clinical trials, further clinical trials may be called for to evaluate the mechanism of action of adverse reaction. In some instances, pharmacodynamic and pharmacokinetic studies might also be conducted to determine whether a particular dosing instruction can put patients to an increased risk of adverse event. A genetic testing at this time point may also provide clues about which group of patients might be at an increased risk of adverse reactions. Based on the pharmacological properties and the expected use of medicinal product in general practice, conducting specific studies to investigate potential drug-drug interaction and food-drug interaction might be called for. An important aspect in the post-marketing studies also includes the drug utilization studies. These studies describe how a medicinal product is prescribed and used in routine clinical practice in larger population, including the geriatric, pediatric patients and pregnant females, or the patients with hepatic or renal dysfunction who are often excluded by randomized clinical trials. They are generally being stratified according to age, gender, concomitant medication and other characteristics that allow the comprehensive characterization of treated patients, including the distribution of those factors that may influence the clinical, social, and economic outcomes. These studies also help to monitor use in everyday medical practice and medication error, and to determine whether a medicinal product has potential for abuse by examining whether patients are taking the regimens or whether there is evidence of inappropriate repeat prescribing. Now we will move to फार्माकोविजिलेंस. फार्माकोविजिलेंस इज द साइंस एंड एक्टिविटीज रिलेटिंग टू द डिटेक्शन, असेसमेंट, अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड प्रिवेंशन ऑफ एडवर्स इफेक्ट्स और एनी अदर ड्रग रिलेशन. मेजर एम्स ऑफ फार्माकोविजिलेंस आर अर्ली डिटेक्शन ऑफ अननोन सेफ्टी प्रॉब्लम्स, identification of risk factors, quantifying risk, detection of increase in frequency of known risk, preventing patients from being affected by certain problems, drug-drug interaction, and concomitant medication. Coming to the basic concepts of pharmacovigilance, we need to learn certain definitions, first being adverse event. An adverse event is any untoward medical occurrence in a patient or clinical investigation subject administered a pharmaceutical product and which does not necessarily have to have a causal relationship with this treatment. Next term, adverse drug reaction. In pre-approval phase, it is defined as all noxious or unintended responses to a medicinal product related to any dose. In post-approval phase, it is defined as a response to a drug which is noxious and unintended and which occurs at doses normally used in man for prophylaxis, diagnosis or therapy of disease or for modification of physiological function. Coming to an important definition, serious adverse event. A serious adverse event is an event that results in death or is life-threatening or that result in hospitalization or prolongation of existing hospitalization or that results in persistent or significant disability or incapacity or that results in congenital anomaly or birth defect. Next term, unexpected adverse drug reaction or adverse event. It is an event whose nature, severity, specificity, or outcome is not consistent with the current approved labeling for the drug product. The criteria for a valid adverse drug reaction are identifiable patient, identifiable reporter, at least one event would have happened and at least one company suspect the product. Now coming to the periodic safety update reports, they are often abbreviated as PSURs every 6 months for the initial 2 years and thereafter annually for next 2 years. These PSURs should be submitted to the regulatory body. These are designed to provide the regulators with an update of the worldwide safety data of a marketed drug, biological product, or a medical device at defined time intervals. It is considered to be an important pharmacovigilance tool as it is designed to include the safety data on a particular drug from all the sources and geographical regions. PSUR contain the relevant clinical and non-clinical safety data only for the period of report. The periodic safety update reports due for a period must be submitted within 30 calendar days for the last day of reporting period. Now coming to the methods for post authorization safety studies. First is active surveillance. This is done to ascertain the number of adverse events in a given population via a continuous organized process. An example of active surveillance is the follow-up of patients treated with a particular medicinal product through a risk management system. Patients who fill a prescription for this product may be asked to complete a brief survey form and give permission for later contact. In general, it is more feasible to get comprehensive data on individual adverse event reports through an active surveillance system. Next, intensive monitoring schemes. The major strength of such systems is that the monitors may document important information about the events and exposure to medicinal products. The major limitation is the need to maintain a trained monitoring team over the time. Intensive monitoring may be achieved by reviewing the medical records or interviewing patients or physicians, pharmacists in a sample of sentinel sites to ensure complete and accurate data on reported adverse events. Prescription event monitoring. Patients may be identified from electronic prescription data or automated health insurance claims. A follow-up questionnaire can then be sent to each prescribing physician or patient at pre-specified intervals to obtain outcome information. The information on patient demographics, indication for treatment, duration of therapy, including the start dates, dosage, clinical events, and reasons for discontinuation can be included in the questionnaire. The limitation of prescription event monitoring include incomplete physician response and limited scope to study products which are used exclusively in hospitals. More detailed information on adverse event from a large number of physicians or patients may be collected. Now, in the end, I will be sharing certain softwares which are required during the clinical trial. For clinical trial management, softwares like OpenClinica, real-time clinical trial management system, which is required for the patient management, recruitment, and investigator management. The other softwares like Clinical Trial, Macro, eClinical Suite for CRF designing, annotation, data entry, and data validation. For pharmacovigilance, the following softwares are used like Argus, PVNet, Eris Global. These are required for drug safety databases, VigiFlow and VigiBase. These are required during post-marketing surveillance at sponsor site and CRO site. So students, in the present module, we have learned about the post-marketing surveillance studies, which are generally observational in nature. A detailed description of pharmacovigilance related activities are also being covered. We have also learned about the names of different softwares required during clinical trials at different phases. Thank you.